Welcome to all of you. First of all, before starting our session, I want to thankful to my professor HOD, Dr. Raju Devarajan, for excellency in guiding us to run this program, this online class. Once again, I am welcoming for this online class. Due to this COVID crisis, we have started this online classes with the help of my professor, actually Dr. Raju Devarajan. Today my topic is chemotherapy of erythematosus, part 2. The part 1 was taken by Dr. Ramesh Chandra. This is a continuation of part 1. Before entering into the class, I want to brief about this chemotherapy and the subheadlines of introduction, the types of erythematosus, then dealing with the individual drugs. With the introduction part, this erythematosus is nothing but a worm infestation occur due to the infection of the worms. The worm infestation is one of the major global health problems nowadays due to the, it depends upon the poverty, illiteracy, and lack of pure sanitation, and where there is a poor water supply, mainly seen in the tropical countries. In the tropical, depends upon the environmental conditions. The commonest parasites involved observed are roundworms, hookworms, threadworms, tapeworms, filarial worms, and as schistosomes. These worms can cause various gastrointestinal and general symptoms, causing the gastrointestinal disturbances. And some of the symptoms occurring with these worm infestations are, there may be a blood loss, nutritional deficiencies, and there's a urticaria, and some other allergic manifestations. In severe conditions, it may lead to the intestinal obstruction, and there will be a hepatosplenomegaly, and with the commonly with the nematodes infestation, there is the diagnostic part, there will be a peripheral blood eosinophilia. In common with roundworms, there will be a bronchial spasm leading to the difficulty in breathing, especially with the roundworms. Coming to the individual drugs, that is my part. Before that, in part 1, you have come to know that about albendazole, mebendazole, and thiobendazole, and then filaria, diethylcarbamazepine. Now in this part 2, I am dealing with ivermectin. This ivermectin is originally obtained from the Streptomyces ivermectinis. It is obtained from the soil, especially in the Japanese soil. This is highly effective against a broad spectrum of parasites and some arthropods. It is commonly extensively used in the veterinary medicine. This ivermectin is a drug of choice in onchocerciasis. It is a macrocyclic lactone. Coming to the important part, the how this ivermectin acts, that is the mechanism of action. It mainly activates the glutamate-gated chloride channels. That causes it increases the GABA transmission in the worms. Due to the increased GABA transmission, there is the occurrence of hyperpolarization and paralysis of worms. And that leads to the death of the parasite or phagocytosis of the worms, leading to the death of the parasites. And coming to the pharmacokinetics, it is well absorbed orally, highly protein bound. More than 97% is metabolized in the liver and mostly eliminated in the feces. It is off life is 12 to 56 hours. Coming to the adverse reactions, this ivermectin is a better tolerated. It may cause mild symptoms like itching, skin edema, the painful joint pains, arthralgia, and headache and fever. The another adverse reaction mostly due to the death of the microfilaria, the condition is called as a Maserati reaction, which involves the eyes causing the due to the ocular inflammation. Sometimes it rarely leads to the blindness. This reaction is called as a Maserati reaction. And this should be ivermectin should be avoided in the meningitis. And it not usually along with the CNS depressants because it is a GABA agonistic activity, which is a inhibitory action on the CNS. Along with CNS depressants, if you use in meningitis condition, the patient suffers severe more depression. So it is avoided in the meningitis conditions along with the CNS depressants. Coming to the therapeutic uses, I already told it is a drug of choice in condition like onchocerciasis. This onchocerciasis is be given the dose form. It is a single dose, 150 micrograms per kg is highly effective against microfilaria. However, the adult form is not killed. Then we have to give the advice to repeat the same dose once in 6 to 12 months for 10 to 14 years. If symptoms recur, then the same dose is given every 3 months instead of 6 to 12 months. Every 3 months instead of once a year for the rest of the period to kill the adult worms. Then second condition, it is useful in the lymphatic filariasis. A single dose of 100 to 200 micrograms of kg per kg is highly effective against the microfilaria. A single annual dose of 400 micrograms per kg is effective and safe for prophylaxis. This ivermectin can be used as a prophylactic. There is an annual dose. When there is a condition called with a coexist with this onchocerciasis with loiasis, a single annual dose of 400 micrograms per kg can be used when there is a coexistence, onchocerciasis with loiasis. This is a useful, this dose is when lymphatic filariasis. And one more, intestinal nematode infestation. A single dose of 100 micrograms per kg is used for strongyloiasis. And little bit higher dose of, that is 150 to 200 micrograms per kg, is used when ascaris, trichuriasis and enterobiasis coexist. And one more condition, that in the scabies and a head lice infestation. A single oral dose of 150 to 200 micrograms per kg is very effective. And this ivermectin in conditions can be used with combination. In microfilarial conditions can combine with the doxycycline antibiotic, can give in 200 milligrams daily for 6 weeks. The one more drug, that is a suramin, which is a highly toxic, it can also combine with the ivermectin. Due to its high toxicity, the suramin drug is now, it is not in the market. This ivermectin using alone is less effective. If you combine with doxycycline, there is a synergetic effect in combination in killing the microfilaria. Coming to the second drug, that is the praziquantel. The praziquantel is a pyrazino-isoquinoline compound. It is highly effective against schistosomes, flukes like liver fluke, lung fluke, intestinal flukes. These schistosomes causing the tinnitus and cysticercosis. Coming to the praziquantel, how it acts, that the mechanism of action is very important. The drug increases the permeability of the cell membrane to calcium ions so that there is a lot of influx of the calcium ions that leading to a strong muscular contractions and thereby tegmental damage causing the schistosome to detach from the wall of the vein. This praziquantel having a negligible effect on ova. So remember this mechanism of action, it increases the permeability of cell membrane, there will be an increase of calcium ions. Due to the calcium ions increase, there is a muscular contractions. That muscular contractions, there is a damage in the tegmental, causing the schistosome to detach from the cell membrane, from the wall of the vein. So that there is a removal of the parasites from the cell membrane, causing finally to the death of the parasites. This is a flowchart of the mechanism of action showing praziquantel. There is an increase in flux of calcium ions into the tegment, that is the cell membrane, increase in muscle contraction, and there is a spastic paralysis. Even at a high concentration, it damages the cell membrane, causing the death of the parasite. Every drug, its mechanism of action is very important. To remember the what are the differences, the, how they act. Coming to the pharmacokinetics of the praziquantel, it is rapidly absorbed when given orally. It is significant amount of the drug is metabolized during the first pass. This absorption is increased with the high carbohydrate meal. It acts within 1 hour of ingestion and plasma half-life is 1.5 hours. Approximately 70 to 80% of a dose is excreted in urine within 24 hours. In adverse reactions of praziquantel. It depends upon the dose. Usually mild and present as some symptoms like headache, anorexia, drowsiness. Then one more, there will be nausea, there is abdominal pain, and a pruritus. It is sometimes it causes the, it depends upon the dose. In increasing dose, it causes the hallucinations, and there will be a chance of getting excitement or psychotic symptoms. They are also useful in the treating the condition called Katayama fever. It is a hypersensitive reaction. This reaction is mainly treated with the combination with the glucocorticoids. Katayama fever. Then this is a non-mutagenic, non-carcinogenic, so it is very safe in the using in the children and in a pregnant woman. This is praziquantel. Then coming to the therapeutic uses. Condition called schistosomiasis is a drug of choice. That depends in the different parasites in the different dose. That is the schistosoma hematobium, the dose is 40 milligrams per kg. Then schistosoma mansoni is 60 milligrams per kg. And schistosoma japonicum, the 60 milligrams per kg. Then coming to the cure rate of, this is 80 to 90% has been noticed in schistosoma hematobium and 60% other species. Because of its short plasma half-life, it is not used as a prophylactic. Then coming to the praziquantel, cannot kill the migrating larva that are 3 to 21 days old. Then it can given in combination with the artemether to kill the migrating larva. The dose of artemether given, the dose of 6 mg/kg every 2 weeks. This combination of the artemether with the praziquantel is there is a synergistic efficacy in killing the adult worms. The other condition is the other fluke infestations. This is highly effective against the lung flukes and intestinal flukes. And the recommended dose is the 25 mg/kg that can be given in the divided into 3 doses given on the same day. And one more in the teniasis. A single dose of 10 mg/kg is recommended in the morning for tenias solium and tenias aeruginata. A single dose of 20 mg/kg is recommended in the morning for Lyphilobiothrum latum and Haemorrhoides nana. This is the drug of choice in the tenias solium, tenias aeruginata and Lyphilobiothrum latum. This is given in the morning on the empty stomach followed by a single dose after 1 hour. And this is given in the early morning orally so that it can combine easily absorbed in the intestine, so that the scolex is identified and killed. The one more, neurocysticercosis, that is condition occurs in the CNS. The dose given is the 50 mg/kg per day in 3 divided days for at least 2 weeks, that is 14 days. The hepatitis disease, it may be used as an adjuvant to the, along with the albendazole. The hepatitis disease. Then one more important drug, that is the niclosamide. It is the second drug of choice for the tenias aeruginata, Lyphilobiothrum latum, and Haemophilus nana. Coming to the important point, that is the mechanism of action of this niclosamide acts. This is mainly a vermicidal drug. I think vermicidal means killing the worms. Then mechanism of action is that it inhibits the oxidative phosphorylation in the mitochondria of the parasite and rapidly kills adult worms, but is not effective in the killing the ova. Main important point is that it inhibits the oxidative phosphorylation in the mitochondria of the parasite, then kills the adult worms. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it is orally and poorly absorbed. It is metabolized in the liver and excreted in the urine. The adverse effects are the common conditions like nausea, vomiting, headache, and there will be allergic manifestations like skin rashes and itching. Coming to the therapeutic use of niclosamide, I already told is a drug of choice in the tenias solium, tenias aeruginata, Lyphilobiothrum latum, and Haemophilus nana. This the dose is very important. The dose depends upon is after keeping the patient on a low residue diet, 1 day before, and fasting overnight. This dose is very important. This is due to the absorption in the intestine that is given in the empty stomach. That is, 2 tablets of the drug, 1 gram, are given in the early morning on empty stomach. And another 1 gram after 1 hour. That is the second dose. After giving 2 doses, a saline purge may be given 1 to 2 hours after the second dose, especially in the tenias solium infestations. Coming, that is the part 2 of these drugs, that is the ivermectin, praziquantel, and niclosamide. Coming to the other topic, that is the chemotherapy of other protozoal infections. which is also included in the elementiasis. The main condition is the leishmaniasis. It is a vector-borne infection caused by an intracellular protozoonous leishmania. The drug used in is used in. What are the drugs used in this leishmaniasis? The main drugs are the pentavalent antimony compounds. The drugs are sodium stibogluconate and meglumen antimonate. These are the pentavalent antimony compounds. They can be asked in the short notes. Leishmaniasis drugs. You should write, it's the pentavalent antimony compounds, dimidine derivative, and a miscellaneous. Dimidine derivative is the pentamidine isothionate. The miscellaneous drugs are the antifungal, that is the amphotericin B, miltefosin, and aminosidin. These are the drugs used in the leishmaniasis. These are short notes. You can ask for short notes. Then coming to the individual drug, that is the common drug used in the leishmaniasis. Sodium stibogluconate. Important is mechanism of action. It is the most preferred drug in the leishmaniasis. The mechanism of action is actually, it is not a clear. It is a idiopathic, and probably it can act by suppressing both glycolysis and fatty acid metabolism, and by diminishing the generation of the ATP and GTP in the mastocytes. This is a big important mechanism of action. If they are acting, they are suppressing the both glycolysis and fatty acid metabolism by diminishing the generation of the ATP and GTP in the mastocyte stage. Coming to the pharmacokinetics of sodium stibogluconate, it can be given by the intravascular or intramuscular. That is the parenteral route. It can be excreted in the two phases. A short phase with plasma half-life of 2 hours. And then second phase, that is a long phase with plasma half-life of 24 hours. That will usually be 33 to 76 hours. That is a long phase. The later phase reflects slow release of the trivalent antimony compound from the tissues, which contributes to the prolonged effects of the drug. This is the later phase. Coming to the adverse reactions. Common adverse effects are the nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, giddiness, local thrombosis, then myalgias, muscular pains, then hepatitis, is the liver damage, and rarely arrhythmias may occur. That is, arrhythmia, there will be a prolongation of QT interval. Then one more drug important, pentamidine. This pentamidine is available in two salt forms, that is isothionate and mesylate. Two salt forms, pentamidine. Main important mechanism of action. This mechanism of action also is not clear, but it can be act by interfering with the amino acid transport. Then it disrupts the mitochondria and inhibit the transformation of mastocytes to promastocytes. Thus, by inhibiting the transformation one stage to another, it interferes with the amino acid transport. That disturbs the mitochondria. Pentamidine. Coming to the pharmacokinetics, it can be administered by parenteral route intramuscular, whereas stibogluconate can be administered intravenous or intramuscular. It is concentrated in the liver and very little gets into the brain tissue. It can be excreted in the urine and it can be detected in the urine for 6 to 8 weeks. Coming to the adverse reactions, When we given intramuscularly, it may cause local irritation at the injection site, breathlessness, there will be a nausea and a vomiting. There will be a facial flushing. There's the allergic manifestations, there's the pruritus and arthralgia and arrhythmias, already told, prolongation of the QT interval and hypotension. There's the falling blood pressure. Then systemic toxicity. It can include the hepatotoxicity, leukopenia, there will be a decrease in platelets, that is thrombocytopenia, and nephrotoxicity, leading to the renal damage. About 5% of the patients develop insulin-dependent diabetes mellitus. The conditions, diabetes, in type 2 diabetes. Coming to the therapeutic uses, that is the visceral and useful in the visceral and mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. It's pentamidin. And the resistant to the pentavalent antibody compound, that is the stevogluconate. In the resistant cases, this pentamidin is useful in the condition visceral and mucocutaneous leishmaniasis. And these are treated with the pentamidin or combination like antifungal drug, amphotericin B. Then one more condition, pneumocystis, urobici, pneumonia. That is in the lung. The dose given is the dose 300 milligrams in the form of aerolation. In the inhaler form, the aerolation pentamidin given every 4 weeks. Appears to be effective in 70% effective in preventing the first episode of pneumonia in patients with acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. Then coming to the one more condition, trypanosomiasis. This pentamidin is given intravenous in the dose of 3 to 4 milligrams of the base per kg body weight on every alternate days for 10 doses. The condition, trypanosomiasis. I want to thank you everyone for giving patience in listening to my few words. Once again, I want to give a message to all of you. Please stay home, stay safe, be healthy, we maintain the healthy condition and work hard for the future. Internal examinations, we are working very hard for these online classes, and also there will be exams, internal exams, and for our the cooperation of our profession and our other faculty members, I'm taking this class. Once again, I thank everyone, each and everyone.